October 5th, 1949, to Marks & Co., 84 Charing Cross Road, London, WC2, England. Gentlemen, your ad in the Saturday Review of Literature says that you specialize in out-of-print books. The phrase antiquarian bookseller scares me somewhat, as I equate antique with expensive. I am a poor writer with an antiquarian taste in books, and all the things I want are impossible to get over here, except in very expensive rare editions. I enclose a list of my most pressing problems. If you have any clean secondhand copies of any of the books on the list for no more than $5 each, will you consider this a purchase order and send them to me? Very truly yours, Helene Hampf.
Dear Madam, in reply to your letter of October the 5th, we have managed to clear up two-thirds of your problem. The three Hazlitt essays you want are contained in the None Such Press edition of his selected essays. And the Stevenson is found in Virginibus Purisque. They're sending nice copies of both these by book post, and trust they will arrive safely in due course and that you will be pleased with them. Our invoice is enclosed with the books. The Leigh Hunt essays are not going to be so easy, but we will see if we can find an attractive volume with them all in. We haven't the Latin Bible you describe, but we have a Latin New Testament, also a Greek New Testament. Ordinary modern editions, cloth binding. Would you like these? Yours faithfully, F.P.D. for Marks & Co.
What kind of a black Protestant Bible is this? Kindly inform the Church of England they have loused up the most beautiful prose ever written. Whoever told them to tinker with the Vulgate Latin? They'll burn for it, mark my words. It's nothing to me, I'm Jewish myself. But I have a Catholic sister-in-law, a Methodist sister-in-law, a whole raft of Presbyterian cousins, through my great-uncle Abraham, who was converted, and an aunt who's a Christian Science healer. And I like to think none of them would countenance this Anglican Latin Bible if they knew it existed. As it happens, they don't know Latin existed. Have you got a copy of Landor's Imaginary Conversations? I think there are several volumes. The one I want is the one with the Greek conversations. If it contains a dialogue between Aesop and Rhodope, that'll be the volume I want.
Forgive me.
Forgive you for what?
For everything. For meeting you in the first place. For taking the piece of grit out of your eye. For loving you. For bringing you so much misery.
I'll forgive you if you'll forgive me.
Thursday.
Please write and tell me about London. I live for the day when I step off the boat train and feel its dirty sidewalks under my feet. I want to walk up Berkeley Square and down Wimpole Street and stand in St. Paul's where John Donne preached and sit on the step Elizabeth sat on when she refused to enter the Tower and places like that. A newspaper man I know who was stationed in London during the war says, tourists go to England with preconceived notions, so they always find exactly what they go looking for. I told him I'd go looking for the England of English literature. And he said, then it's there.
Dear heart, it is the loveliest old shop straight out of Dickens. You would go absolutely out of your mind over it. There are stalls outside, and I stopped and leafed through a few things just to establish myself as a browser before wandering in. It's dim inside. You can smell the shop before you see it. It's a lovely smell. I can't articulate it easily. But it combines must and dust and age and walls of wood and floors of wood. Toward the back of the shop, at the left, there's a desk with a work lamp on it. A man was sitting there with a Hogarth nose. He looked up and said...
Oh, so sorry. Good afternoon. Would you like some help?
May I look around?
Oh, yes. Yes, of course. Please do.
The shelves go on forever. They go up to the ceiling, and they're very old and kind of gray, like old oak that absorbed so much dust over the years they no longer are their true color. There's a print selection, or rather, a long print table with Cruikshank and Rackham and Spy, and all those old, wonderful English caricaturists and illustrators that I'm not smart enough to know a lot about. And there are some lovely, old illustrated magazines. I stayed for about half an hour hoping your Frank or one of the girls would turn up, but it was one-ish when I went in. I gathered they were all out to lunch, and I couldn't stay any longer.
Here I was, curled up in my armchair, so at peace with the world, with something old and serene on the radio, Corelli or somebody, and this thing on the table, this giant modern library thing. So I thought, I will read one of the sermons aloud. You have to read done aloud. It's like a Bach fugue.
All mankind is one volume. When one man dies, one chapter is not torn out of the book, but translated into a better language. And every chapter must be so translated. God employs several translators. Some pieces are translated by age, some by sickness, some by war, some by justice. But God's hand shall bind up all our scattered leaves again. For that library where every book shall lie open to one another.
Dear Helle, it was good to hear from you again. Still here, getting older, busier, but no richer. We had a very pleasant summer with more than the usual number of tourists, including hordes of young people making the pilgrimage to Carnaby Street. We watch it all from a safe distance, though I must say I rather like the Beatles. The fans just wouldn't squeal, so.